Good morning. Before we get started this morning with our worship service, we want to take this opportunity to recognize a very special couple in our congregation. Bob and Phyllis Arnold celebrated their 60th wedding anniversary on Wednesday, April 20th, 2016. They were married on April 20th in 1956. They have one son and one daughter-in-law, Brett and Elaine Arnold. Bob and Phyllis have been members of the Cabot Church of Christ for 31 years. Bob is currently involved in the pantry ministry and strives to make it the best pantry in Cabot. He has been involved in several different activities and ministries. He was part of the Buildings and Grounds ministry, in which he spent countless hours every day up here just doing little handyman jobs, always kind of make sure everything looked good for us. They have been very instrumental in several other different ministries and outreach groups throughout the town and throughout this congregation. They were involved with the senior program and helped get that started, the ladies' Valentine brunch and breakfast. They were part of youth groups at their homes in which bonfires were built and games were played and devotionals were taken care of. They were part of in-reach groups, and if you're not aware of what an in-reach group, before we had agape groups, we had in-reach groups. They have hosted large get-togethers of different members of the congregation. If you ever attended one of Bob's New Year's Eve parties or Christmas parties, it was an event to remember. They also were very important in getting the 50-year board set up that is in our atrium now. Bob is very instrumental also when there's a funeral at the building that he makes sure everything is taken care of for that. When I asked Bob if he had any special thoughts regarding their marriage, this was his comment. He said, "No man could ever ask for any better support to me than the support Phyllis gave me. She had such a gentle, quiet spirit, but friendly to all, a great lady." And they are a great couple, and we want to recognize you, Bob and Phyllis, on your anniversary. May God bless you both.
Good morning. If you're visiting with us, you're our honored guest. We're thankful you've come our way. It's a little odd this morning because as I stand here, I'm thinking of a lady that ought to be sitting right over here with her Sonic cup. And I know you were as shocked as I was early yesterday morning, and I just, our concern is for Jordan and Jalen, and I just pray that you'll help me and all of us stand together to support those two kids. Bob Arnold, when I think about Bob, I could say a lot of things, but I thought to myself, I'm going to narrow it down to just one word, and it's thoughtful. It's thoughtful. Bob is constantly thinking about other people. Just a few weeks ago, Bob came into my office, and maybe it hasn't been 2 weeks ago, just recently. Came into my office, and we were visiting, as we do from time to time, and he said, 6 years. And I said, 6 years? And he said, yeah, you will have been here 6 years in June. And I thought to myself, how do you keep up with that? Who knows that? And he said, you remember the email that I sent you before you even moved here? And I said, you know, I do remember that. Just thoughtful. That's Bob. And Bob, we appreciate you and Phyllis. We love you both so much. And what an inspiration and example you are to this church family. Turning your Bibles to Acts chapter 2, as we're going to spend some time there together. At 16, my parents said, go get a job. And so I did. And their point was, it was good for me. I, you know, was excited about it. But their point was, we want you to learn responsibility. You need to learn to make a little money and to save a little money and to spend your own money instead of spending ours. They wanted to drive home the point of responsibility, and I think they did. Parents push their kids when it comes to school and college and the value in education, and we see that value in education. We want our kids to choose their career and not a job choose them. And so we're constantly encouraging them, you need to go to school, you need to study, you need to work hard. And reality is, this morning, if we see the value in something, we'll do it. We just will. We see the value in our families, and we are devoted to our families. We see the value in our careers, and we're going to be there. My question as we begin today is, do we see the value of a church family? Do we see the value of a church family? Acts chapter 2, the context in verses 42 through 47, these are the new Christians. Some 3,000 that respond on Pentecost and are baptized into Christ. Thus, the church has been established. And I want you to see how they roll, if you will. See how they interact. See how they do things. In Acts chapter 2, starting in verse 42, he says, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and miraculous signs were done by the apostles. All the believers, verse 44, were together and had everything in common. I want you to see, first of all, this morning, church family provides needed relationships. There's not a person in here, young and mature, that doesn't need relationships. God has so wired us inside and out to be relational, to have relationships with others. And we think, well, what's the big deal about this church family thing? We stroll in, we sing a few songs, we break a cracker, sip the juice, and we go to lunch. What's the big deal? And it's far more to it than that. Because we get phone trees like we did yesterday morning. And we realize that's when the church family has to step up. That's when the church family has to wrap their arms around these kids and say, you know what? We're going to support you. We'll be there to watch you run, Jordan or Jalen. They both run, swim. And their mama was at everything. Verse 44. These new Christians were together constantly. You see, the church family meets the need through healthy relationships. These Christians spent time together. They developed relationships. Notice the phrase had everything in common. And we may say, how in the world did these early first Christians have everything in common? And I think the answer is they knew each other. They were constantly together, constantly in one another's homes, as we'll see later, constantly sharing a meal together, constantly in fellowship somehow or another together. They knew one another. You see, church family provides needed relationships. They became family to one another. You heard TJ, our youth minister, in the video that we did for advertising this day, Friends Day. He said, my church family is my family. As many do, he and his wife live away from family. Her family recently moved to the area. But for many years, they've been away from family. So who do they rely on? Their church family. Aren't many of us in that boat? Absolutely. And that's exactly how these Christians interacted and handled things even in the first century. Church family provides needed relationships. I mentioned a minute ago how God has wired us to be relational. We just need relationships. Nobody, we joke and we laugh and say, if I could just go to the middle of the woods somewhere and build a cabin and never see anyone. If I could just go to an island, a remote island where nobody is. But we need relationships. Do you remember that silly movie, and this is my opinion, Castaway? Never get that time back. But that movie, and if you liked it, that's okay, but it was just odd to me. But what did he do? There was nobody else there, and he starts having a conversation with, what was it, a soccer ball or something? A pineapple, a coconut? He makes friends. We're relational. That's what we do. We have relationships. And the early church did as well. Gang members would say, maybe not all of them, but many would say, I had no family. Broken home, didn't know my dad. Mom didn't care about me, but this gang does. This gang is my family. And so many young people would get involved in these gangs that do horrible, you know, terrible crimes, but they would get involved in those gangs but for a need of relationships. This is my family. Church family provides needed relationships. Let's move on. Secondly, look at verse 45, Acts 2. Verse 45. Selling their possessions and goods, they gave to anyone as he had need. So, church family provides needed support. These Christians so got the family concept. They understood it. They viewed one another as family, that they would provide for one another. They would provide support. What's mine is yours, what's yours is mine. They had that mentality. We really don't, but they did. They so got that. And they would take care of one another. The context is referring to physical and financial needs and support being provided. They would sell possessions to meet needs. And they gave to their brother or sister. Anyone that had a need, if they needed to sell something to make sure their brother or sister was cared for, they just did it. It was no big deal to them. It was not, well, we need to think about this and talk about it, and I'm not sure. Let me get with my financial advisor and see if this is going to benefit me or how this is going to work on time. Man, they didn't care. They just took care of one another. They just met needs. Church family provides needed support. Selling their possessions. I don't know if that's something we would do. Acts chapter 4, 32 and following says, All the believers were one in heart and mind. No one claimed that any of his possessions was his own, but they shared everything they had with great power. The apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and much grace was upon them all. But they said, even their possessions, it weren't theirs. They shared them. If they needed to sell them, they would sell them to meet a need. If they needed to give a possession to someone else, they just did. Because church family provides needed support, needed relationships, as we mentioned, but also needed support. Now, this, again, is talking about in Acts 2, financial, physical support. But sometimes a church family also provides emotional support. I'm proud of this church family for a number of reasons, but let me stop for a minute and tell you this. As I was leaving the house yesterday morning, when I made it over to the house where Jordan and Jalen live, TJ was sitting on the couch with them. And as we left together, another lady, Sharon Stevens, shows up. Countless times I'm going in and out of hospitals, countless times, and I'm running into elders or elders' wives or both or church members who are just see the need to go and be with someone. And I can't name them. There's so many. But I leave there every time think, man, we're doing something right. This is good. Because that's what the church does. Church family provides needed support. Let's don't, we think, well, digging in your pockets, that's no big deal. Here, take the $50 and go provide for your family, or let me sell something and give, whatever the case is. But when we talk about the emotional support, there's been a death, there's been a tragedy, and the church family steps in, or there's a need at the hospital, and the church family steps in. That's emotional support, and that's what church family does. We go through things in this life, and we need a support system. And I want to stress this next statement. Church family is there for non-judgmental support. I don't care. I'm sorry. It's irrelevant to me what you do, if you need my support, I'm going to be there to support you. Period. Church family provides non-judgmental support. When we step into, the judgmental side, at some point we cease to become family. My kids make mistakes and I may not like it, but I'm not going to be judgmental. I may make sure there's a lesson involved and we don't do this again. That's where we got to be. Non-judgmental support. Provide the emotional support. You say, well, why don't more congregations lean on one another? Why don't we know one another better? I think that reason. We're afraid we're going to be judged. We're concerned of what others are going to think. What are you going to say about the skeletons in my closet? What are you going to think when you find out about this? Whatever. We're family. And I got news for you. I hate to burst your bubble this morning, but there is nobody in this family that's perfect. So there's nobody in this family that has a right to be judgmental. It is what it is. How do people make it through this life with all the ups and the downs, with all the peaks, the valleys, without a church family? We're doing our grief share, and Monday, tomorrow night's our last grief share. But with grief share, I've learned, how vital it is to have a church family. We have people that are grieving, people that have lost children, people that are really, really struggling in there. And the question has come up many times, how do we get through this without the support of a church family? I think that is a very vital question. Church family provides needed relationships. Church family provides needed support. Look at verse 46. Thirdly, church family provides needed accountability. And we may not like this one. Verse 46, every day, these new Christians continue to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and they ate together with glad and sincere hearts. But every single day they met together. This is accountability. One of the things hurting the church today is lack of accountability, because where there is lack of accountability, Christians slip through the cracks. And we turn around and we say, where's brother so-and-so? Anybody checked on him? What about sister? Anybody miss her? You say, well, we're just a big congregation. Well, then we got to work together. There are no excuses. There must be accountability. You have accountability with your children. We're not going to act like this. You're going to be home at this time. You're going to take care of these chores. That's accountability. Hey, what were you doing last night? What's going on? That's accountability. You say, I don't want anybody prying into my life. I don't want anybody. That's what church family does. And it's not to be judgmental. It shouldn't be. I really believe one of the things hurting the church universally today is a lack of accountability. We go, we show up at the building, we sing our songs, we break the cracker and sip the juice, and we cut a trail to the restaurant, we have lunch, and we go about our week. We'll see you next Sunday morning. I'm not saying we need to spend all of our time together, but we need to have relationships with one another. We need to spend some time together. There must be accountability. If there are no relationships, and you can look at the studies, when new people come in, if they don't form a relationship relatively quick, they're not staying. It doesn't matter how wise and great your shepherds are, how wonderful and dynamic your song leaders are, or who the preacher is. It makes no difference. If they don't develop relationships pretty quick, they're not sticking. They're not staying. I mean, go look at the studies on that. That's just reality. There must be accountability. Church family provides that needed accountability. This early church, they were together every day. They ate together in their homes. They knew each other. You see, when someone comes in your home, they know you. They see the pictures on the wall, the awards, the things you've accomplished, who your mom and daddy were. They see these things. And what those things are conversation pieces. that gets you into their lives. So, well, my home's not very big and my home's not very nice. It's not really what it's about. That's irrelevant. When you let someone into your home, you're letting them into your life, into your world, your private space. These Christians were in their homes together and they met together every day, not just on Sunday. They were constantly meeting together. And see, here's the thing. If they're together that often, guess what? They notice if someone is missing. They realize, you know, he hadn't been here 2 weeks. Anybody know where he is? Oh, he's on vacation. Oh, okay, but we have him accounted for. Or no, nobody knows. Well, then we need to hightail it to his house and check on him. Accountability. Well, I don't want to be nosy. If you're family, that's not being nosy. You know what's going on with each other. You know the struggles one another has when you're together that often. Today, we try to hide our struggles from brothers and sisters, and I think we do. I think that's obvious. I mean, that's no front page news. I mean, we try to hide our struggles as if we don't struggle, and we all do. We struggle with things. We just don't want other people to know. I'm not sure about that. Why that is, because when other people know, they can pray for us. You see, they were in one another's homes. They got to know each other constantly. Turn over James 5 for a bit. Hold your place there in Acts 2, and let's look at a passage or two in James 5 real quick. James chapter 5, talking about this accountability the church family provides. James 5 verse 16 simply says, therefore confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous man is powerful and effective. Now here's the thing. Doesn't say, and I know I'm beating this to death, but just go with me. He doesn't say confess your sins to each other so that everybody will know and everybody can tell everybody else your business and so that they can come down on you and criticize and all that kind of stuff. He says confess your sins to each other so you can be healed. Well, how are you going to be healed? They're going to be praying for you. They're going to know your struggle and your weakness and what you're dealing with, and they're going to pray for you. Not be judging you, but praying for you. That's accountability. James 5, 19. My brothers, if one should wander from the truth and someone should bring him back, remember this, whoever turns a sinner from the error of his way will save him from death and cover over a multitude of sins. That's accountability. When we go to our brother and sister and say, you know, I haven't seen you in a long time. I'm concerned about where you are spiritually. What's going on in your life? What's happened? Have we done something? Have we hurt you? Have we offended you? What's going on? That's accountability. And there's not a mother, father, grandfather, or grandmother that if their child called from wherever in the U.S. and said, I'm hurting, I need you here, would not be there. And that's where we need to be as a church family. That's where we need to be. That's where they were. Needed relationships, needed support. Needed accountability. And finally, verse 47, church family provides needed growth. Praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people, and the Lord added to their number daily those who are being saved. These Christians worshiped together. They were growing. The Lord added to their number refers to the physical and the numerical growth. God gives the increase. The elders don't, the deacons don't, the preacher and the Bible class, they don't give the increase. God gives the increase, but a church family who worships together will grow spiritually. And I've said this and I believe this. Spiritual growth precedes numerical growth. Because when we're growing individually spiritually, we're going to be doing the things we need to do that will bring about physical growth. And there are some things that we have to do. Look in 1 Corinthians chapter 3 real quick. 1 Corinthians 3, 5 and 6. What after all is Apollos, Paul writes. What is Paul? only servants through whom you came to believe as the Lord has assigned to each his task. I planted the seed and Apollos watered it, but God made it grow. And see, when we're growing spiritually, we're going to have some planters. And when we're growing spiritually, there'll be some people that are more than happy to water. And then God will give the increase. But if we're not growing spiritually, we're not going to plant. If we're not growing spiritually in our relationship with God, we're not going to water. This is going to be a priority to us. Spiritual growth precedes numerical growth. And a church that's not growing spiritually struggles to grow physically. A church family worships together, studies together, prays together, grows spiritually together. And I want to say this as we close out. Everybody, all of us, need to work together to encourage spiritual growth. In 2 Peter chapter 3, the last thing that Peter writes, he says in verse 18, 2 Peter 3:18, grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Grow spiritually. Grow in your relationship with Jesus. See, being a Christian is not about finding your favorite seat in the auditorium and being there every Sunday and Sunday night and Wednesday. I mean, that's part of it, but that's not even near half of it. There's so much more to being a Christian, and a big part is spiritual growth. Church family provides needed relationships, and we all need those. Church family provides needed support, maybe physical and financial, but certainly emotional. Church family provides needed accountability that we've got to work on. And church family provides needed growth. When we grow spiritually, God's going to give the physical increase. God will take care of his business when we take care of our business in growing spiritually. As individuals, when one sees the value of a church family, one will have a church family. Today, if we can help you, if you're struggling with something and need the prayers of this church family, or maybe you're here and need to respond and be baptized to have your sins washed away, whatever your need is, if it be physical or spiritual, we want to help you. We'll have an elder up here waiting for you if you'll come. Together we stand and as we sing.